will never disappear. I've seen that road before. It always leads me here, lead me to your door. That the rain washed away, has left a pool of tears, crying for the day. Why leave me standing here?
Some breaking news coming to us here via Thames Valley Police, who have confirmed the death of the singer George Michael at the age of 53.
Some sad breaking news to bring you. There are reports that George Michael, the singer and songwriter, has died. He was
British
just
pop star George Michael has passed away at the age of 53.
It's the song that had the world tapping their toes. That little ditty, "Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go." It was 1984, and they were the British boy duo known as Wham. They had several top 10 hits together, but really it was George Michael with that statement t-shirt, alluring eyes, and super moves who quickly took the spotlight, sealing his fame with this chart-topping ballad, "Careless Whisper."
Time can never end. Careless
Michael split from bandmate Andrew Ridgely in 1986 and launched his solo career, never looking back, but heading straight into his first big culture clash. It was 1987, George Michael looking the confident rock star now in this provocative video with an equally provocative title. The song's lyrics were considered by some to be, well, raunchy. The legendary Casey Kasem refused to say the title of the song on his American Top 40 radio show, and even some pop radio stations wouldn't play the song until after dark. Michael's lyrics invoking the pleasures of sex bumped heads with not just conservatives who thought he'd gone too far, but with a Hollywood desperate to bring attention to the AIDS epidemic and the need for safe sex. Michael would later say his lyrics were misunderstood. By the late 1980s, George Michael was a bona fide superstar, garnering awards, hanging with celebs and royalty, and delivering more hits, like Father Figure. One More Try. It can be said the 1990s weren't quite as kind to George Michael. Fewer smash hits, and then this. April 7th, 1998. Michael is arrested by an undercover male police officer and charged with engaging in a lewd act at a park in Beverly Hills, California. It took no time for his arrest to become an international headline. On CNN, not long after the arrest, Michael confirmed what had long been rumored. He was gay.
I want people to know that I have not been exposed as a gay man in any way that I feel, I don't feel any shame for, I feel stupid and I feel reckless and weak for having allowed my sexuality to be exposed this way. But I don't feel any shame whatsoever and neither do I think I should.
In later years, there were more scuffles with the law, drug-related arrests, and a nasty car accident in 2010. Michael was found to be driving under the influence of cannabis and went to jail. But there was always the music. At nearly age 50, Symphonica, his creative masterpiece with full orchestra, a critical success.
The first time ever I saw your face.
I still believe that music is one of the greatest gifts that God gave to man, George Michael once said. Lucky for us, he left us plenty of it.
This CD I bought in 84, I think it was, and this was the first CD I ever bought, and actually it was the first CD you were able to buy in Jutland, in this part of Jutland. And I think for many people in my generation, we grew up with your music, we fell in love with your music, mm-hmm. and got married with your mm-hmm. music, and all these...
Had lots of babies with your music. What
does it feel like to have provided the soundtrack to so many people's lives?
Well, it's a privilege, isn't it? It's an amazing privilege. I mean, I've been very aware of it and felt very responsible for kind of handling that privilege with care. Not many people really are that meticulous with what they do, I suppose, and I'm just a control freak and terribly afraid of failure or regret. So I work very hard at these things, and I hope people will feel that in the show as well, you know.
You have been in the spotlight for almost three decades. Mm-hmm. How have you coped, or how are you coping with the media attention and fuss and...
As badly as ever, really. I've just been on a holiday on an island and just for 4 days, and I think pretty much everybody in the island has my picture now. I'm a little too polite for my own good, really.
You don't get used to it over the years?
No. It gets stranger over the years, actually, because the longer people have seen a two-dimensional, you know, whether it be TV or the newspaper, people who've seen you in two dimensions for nearly three decades, you know, since they were children or whatever, when they see the 3D version, they tend to... It's almost like it gets weirder. The experience gets weirder because people's response to you over time gets stronger. Not less necessarily... It doesn't necessarily go with your chart success or whatever. It goes with how long you've been around, you know, and so the response to you gets stronger and stronger, and I think a lot of people don't appreciate that. I think that's why a lot of people like me, who've been around for years and years, only really lose it in their 40s and 50s. You know, there are a lot of people that seem to lose their minds at a certain age, and I think I know why now. You know,
What are you doing to keep that from happening?
I stay home a lot. No, I'm trying to break free of that as well. I try very hard. To thank my lucky stars, you know, and keep it all in proportion and perspective. But it can be very tiring having a smiley face all day for thousands of...
Yeah, no wonder.
And when I travel, that's much more likely to happen, of course.
There were, when you're talking about keeping away from the public, there were 17 years where you did not go on the road. But now you are on the road and on a tour again. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about it now?
One thing I will say about the holiday I just went on, I didn't have any security with me, which is one of the reasons that I spent the whole... That's one thing. So I'm protected from some of that out here. But I obviously feel a very different relationship with the people who come to see the shows than the people, because if it were just my fans that decided they needed my picture, then I think I'd be all right, you know. There are lots of George Michael fans, but there aren't that many, you know. It's the fact that everyone seems to want one, just, you know, in case their wife wants it, or their daughter wants it, or their gay partner wants it. But, you know, I cope with it okay, and the better things are going for me in my life, and the more happy I am with the shows, the better I cope with everything, you know.
But let's go back a bit. Let's talk about those Juan days, because... It must
have been.
Yeah, we must. Yeah.
No, I'm not. I have no problem talking about Wham. I have a problem watching Wham. But, you know, I had a great time. I'm really glad the way it all turned out.
What about... tell us about Andrew and about the meeting him and the effect it had on your life.
Andrew I met when I was 11 years old. 11 or 12 years old? I think 11. I just changed schools. My father... we moved house and I changed schools when I was 11. And Andrew was appointed to look after me. You know, when the new kid walks in and stands there looking really sheepish and they say, who would like to take care of this? And Andrew, for some reason, put his hand up and said, I will, miss. And the rest is history, really. It was a very, very strong, powerful relationship. And it changed my life, and it changed my way of looking at so many things that I really think that without Andrew, I would have... been in a totally different place right now.
What happened to Andrew? I mean, where is he?
Andrew's the smart one. Andrew's off surfing in Cornwall. And he really, I mean, he's taken a real bashing over the years, you know, because I'm still here. I sound like Shirley MacLaine in that movie. What's that movie? Postcards from the Edge. Because I'm still here, Andrew gets a constant drubbing. Every time his name comes up in association with me, he will almost... uniformly gets slagged off. And I think over the years that's had quite a negative effect on the way he views the industry, the way he views those days in Wham. But he decided just to get away from it all and went and lived down by the coast. So I don't see much of him anymore.
In that relationship, I mean, you were the creative sense in the you wrote the songs and that sort of thing, but I mean, what was his contribution then? I mean, why was he so significant?
Well, because he had such a sense of humour. I mean, unfortunately for us, you know, the sense of humour that we had, which was very juvenile, because we were juvenile, you know, I left school, he left a little before me, but I left school and 7 or 8 months later I had a record contract, so I was still a kid, you know, and our sense of humour, or our own kind of private sense of humour that I'd built up over the years, I don't know if we thought everyone else would get it, rather than just thinking we were complete tossers. But we were, constantly trying to annoy people, and that's Andrew, actually. That's Andrew all over. Like, you know, with the first we're calling the first album Fantastic, and oh God, I just remembered, I had this horrible flashback. Do you remember a couple of weeks ago, actually you wouldn't have seen it, we're on the MTV Awards, Fergie presented an award to a group called Massive Attack, who I'm a huge fan of, and they're fervent anti-royalists, and I like them, and I really like her, because I've met her a few times, and it was a very embarrassing moment for all involved, but basically she went up to give them their award, and they snubbed her, and they, two of them went like that to her, right? And the horrible truth is, for at least a year, right, after Andrew and I were first famous, whenever anyone would come up to us we hadn't been introduced to, we'd go, huh. Can you imagine that? Within 12 months, the number of people you can do that to, you can imagine, even if nothing else about us had been annoying, right, we would have been blacklisted by them just for that. But, you know, that was us. I mean, that was, we mucked about like that the whole time, and it was fantastic also in the sense that it kept us both grounded, because we had each other to take the piss out of the whole time. So, that is something that I've really missed.
But, I mean, was it fulfilling in the sense of you, you know, enjoying yourself? You're a kid, I mean, there was the glamour of it, there was the money, there was the birds, everything, wasn't there, at that time?
There was the whole thing, and I mean, you know, I think we both kind of gorged on, not the money side of things. Money, really, I was so afraid of money until probably the age of about 28, 30, that it really, I really didn't live in any way according to the money that I was earning. And it actually, Wham wasn't making any money. For the longest time, we were making no money. Our first Top of the Pops, we went home on the bus.
Really?
Yeah. And actually, I remember the night before, we stayed in this little hotel off of Charing Cross Road, because our record company, our little kind of mini record company that we were on at the time, was paying, and they wanted to make sure that we got there in time for Top of the Pops, the first Top of the Pops. So they stuck us in this hotel that couldn't have been more than 80p to a quid a night. And I was sleeping the night before my first Top of the Pops. I had polystyrene sheets, and it was a child-sized bed, so I was like this. I was sitting with my feet over the end of it, thinking, this isn't how it's supposed to be. You know, I'm supposed to be, you know, if you're on Top of the Pops, that means you're famous.
That's right.
In fact, the day after the first Top of the Pops, I was just convinced that everyone would recognise me, you know. I was walking down the street like, watch TV last night? Yeah, and it was horrible, because absolutely nobody did. Nobody recognised me. I think it took about 3 days before someone came up and asked me for my autograph, and I was absolutely shattered when it took that long.
This is of course the desire to be famous as much as anything else.
Oh, yeah. That's what to be recognised, to be recognized. Loved, I suppose.
And when did that fail to be ultimately fulfilling? When did something else come into that? Which it did, of course. That's why you changed tack. Was there a moment when you were with Andrew, or?
I think probably the last year of Wham. That's the reason it was cut short, really. That's the reason we stopped when we were in kind of on top, was because that last year I'd had to actually accept the fact that, having spent 3 or 4 years, you know, totally promoting and writing and going around the world touring, doing the whole thing, I was miserable. And you know, it's the old cliche, you get everything you want, or everything you think you want, and then you suddenly realize that the gap that you thought it would fill is still there. And I think that was a personal thing that took me years and years to resolve. But I did know it after about probably 2.5, 3 years. I knew that this was really not going to, this was not going to make me happy. This was going to keep me famous, and I loved making the music, but actually the whole kind of circus of it was very distressing for me.
Do you play old Wham tapes at home?
No, I can't say I do.
Go on, you do.
I did for a while when The Greatest Hits was out. I'm too busy playing my own records at home. I can't play Wham records. I play George Michael records 24 hours a day. A dog can sing Careless Whisper.
Your dog this afternoon was singing along with you.
My sister does say,
he's looking at the monitor and doing the desk guy.
My sister does say that when there was one time, because I leave my dog with family when I'm abroad, and I was in America for about 6 weeks, 8 weeks in one stretch last year. And my sister said actually that the dog used to go and sit by the radio and she could actually hear my voice when one of my tracks would come and she'd go and sit by the radio. But that shows how much I play them at home, doesn't it?
Let's just close the chapter on Wham. Just let's be reminded, shall we? This is Top of the Pops, probably the Top of the Pops you're talking about.
Anyway, it's been really nice. But there you go. I mean, those awful T-shirts with number ones that actually my mother and my sister spent all night sewing on little things. I mean, there you go. Apart from looking terrible, how annoying. You know, how annoying must we have been to all those bands at the time that we were competing with that would be that tacky and cheesy to do that. But we thought it was funny. It's just that everyone else thought we were completely for real, you know? That's my version of it.
'm sorry I can't be there in person, but it's beneath me, if we're being honest. I've won Golden Globes and Emmys. Real Emmys, not international Emmys. The real thing. But thank you for this, Best Comedy Actor, for my portrayal in the Extras Christmas special, in which Gordon Ramsay plays a foul-mouthed egomaniac and George Michael plays a hairy, kebab-eating, drug-taking pop star who likes to look for cock in the bushes. Where do I get my ideas from? Hardly a stretch, was it?
Well, I don't like kebabs.
What?
I don't even like kebabs.
Oh, my mistake.
Tara Masalata.
Bless you. All right. Hey, why are you wearing pyjama bottoms?
Don't like the feel.
Why is it so red?
Wear and tear, isn't it?
Not sure then. Look how red this is.
Go on then.
Look how red it is.
Still available.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
That's what you call the family team.
George, you are the first musical artist to play at the brand new Wembley. Did they call you or did you call them?
Oh, I called them, definitely. Definitely. It just occurred to me last year when I heard that everything was going to be late and that those gigs last year, I think it was Bon Jovi, The Stones and Robbie, I think, were supposed to play here last summer. And when I worked out that they weren't going to be able to, I thought, well, there's a possibility you could actually sneak in there next year. So I approached the board and said, you know, I'd love to be the first and please keep me in mind, you know. And they came down to the shows at Earl's Court and obviously decided I was worthy.
Now, George, for me, your best performance at Wembley, but that's probably because it's the only one I actually saw live.
Oh, really? You were there?
It's 1992, the Freddie Mercury tribute concert. Mm-hmm. Now, he was a pretty good live performer.
He was one of the ultimate performers. In terms of charisma, there are very few people that can stand up to Freddie Mercury. There are some people that you can honestly look at and believe that that was what they were meant to do. He was such an unusual and original talent.
Now, that night, the Freddie Mercury tribute concert, there were a lot of nervous performers backstage because they had to sort of, not emulate him, but they had to try and recreate what he did for a living and sing some of his songs. Mm. What was it like backstage for the artists?
I think everyone was a bit overwhelmed by what they had to do because as a vocalist, he had such a range and he wrote things that would take him from right in the bottom of his range to the very top, which was well beyond most people's. So I think it was quite scary for everyone. I mean, I rehearsed for a week. I was the only person. I was like there at school a week before with Brian and John and Roger, and I was literally there every day for a week because I was just not going to get this wrong.
In typical George Michael style, you gave yourself an exceptionally hard time by picking a really, really difficult song, Somebody to Love.
Yeah, it's a tough song, yeah.
I mean, you are George Michael, so you're quite good at singing, but even for you...
I don't know if I chose it. I have a feeling they asked me to sing that one.
Oh, no, that's a bit...
Well, I did, yeah. I thought, how on earth am I going to do that? And obviously I had to dodge some of the notes.
Did you?
Yeah, I dodged some of those. Yeah, there's a couple of falsetto notes in there that I didn't go for. I would never go for the falsetto notes that I went for. I mean, that was 15 years ago, but my God, I wouldn't, on live television, try and hit that high note that I do. I would never have the guts to do that. But live to however many millions of people that was, yeah, that's probably the bravest note I ever hit, yeah. And I was so honoured. And there's a shot in that piece of film where the crowd have done something and you see Brian's face, and Brian is so obviously delighted with that moment. That made me feel proud.
About Wembley Stadium 1986 and Wham! The final, mm-hmm. Right? A huge statement, pretty irreversible, mm-hmm. Okay? What did you think at the time of that statement?
I think I was proud that we did what we said we would do. We, you know, when we talked about it as 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, with our big master plan, of course, that no one knew about.
Was the one really?
There really was. It was completely naive, but it was a plan, you know.
What was the plan again, you know, in 12 words?
In 12 words. I know, the plan was to become the biggest act in the world and then piss off, really.
Then pop.
Yeah.
Literally.
That was the idea, because I think we both saw it as an apprenticeship of sorts for me, you know, and we knew there'd be a point where the two of us together would not, you know, we wouldn't be fresh from school, we wouldn't have that same impact on one another, and there would be a point where the essence of what the group was about would be pointless, you know, would become kind of a parody. And I think that we stopped at a point where that self-parody hadn't had a chance to develop. So I was very proud that we did that, and I was very proud of the number of people who wanted to come and see it, because apparently we could have played for 12 nights, but there had to, it had to be just one night, it had to be one goodbye, you know.
Somebody told me all everything she wants is everything she sees. I guess I must have loved you.
The day itself, people still talk about it. They were at Wham! The final, mm. Okay? Can you describe it briefly for us? The beginning, the middle, and the end.
Well, I seem to remember the beginning of it. I seem to remember Elton had a paddling pool out the back of Wembley, which was a lot less glamorous than this new building is, obviously. In the mid-80s, it was pretty cheap and cheerful around the back of, you know, around the back of the stage. And Elton set up his own little area with a paddling pool, which was quite funny. And he bought me, a three-wheeler, like a Reliant Robin. And I think put my name in the window. I can't remember. But anyway, I seem to remember that early on. And I remember the show itself very sketchily because it was so huge. The event was so huge. And it had to be right. I remember very little about it other than getting through the last three numbers when I'd torn a ligament in my ankle because I always was wearing these ridiculous kind of cowboy boots and did a little jump and landed badly and did that with my foot. So actually the footage of the last two or three songs from the final, I'm actually stomping around on this torn ligament and it's gone completely numb, which is how I got through it. And then when I got home, it went...
So what time did you get home that night?
After the big party at the Hippodrome, so 80s. I think I got home about 3 o'clock, something like that.
So not that late, really, considering you did the concert here.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean... that wasn't when I went to bed. That was just when I got home.
Gotcha.
With many other people. I arrived home with many other people. It was a wonderful day because the audience was absolutely amazing. They were so up for it and everyone was dressed in their summer thing. It was a beautiful day. But the actual show looks, I think, what we'd call rinky-dink now. You know, it really looks like a tiny show in this big, big stadium. Whereas, you know, what we're going to see...
You've learnt. You've evolved.
Well, you know, and that's what goes into life of, you know, shows now. People expect a huge show. But in those days, it was... They thought they were lucky because the curtain fell at the beginning and had the big final thing.
That was enough.
That was enough. That was special effects enough.
Yeah.
Good day. Thank you very much. Thank you for the last 4 years.
George will be with you in 10.
Backstage where George Michael is waiting to go out and perform to over 75,000 screaming fans. It's been 7 years since the residents of Wembley and the surrounding areas heard the unforgettable sounds of our high-octane concert. So the roof's already open. Let's turn the speakers up and musically christen the new Wembley for the first time. This is George Michael.
Anyone take this away from you? Let me see you. See your hands. Hear your voices.
Freedom! 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 You got to give for what you take.
Come on!
Freedom! 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 You got to give for what you take.
Didn't know what I wanted to be.
What an amazing, amazing, amazing.